Tony, we were at the golf course today, but it wasn't for a new Tee It Up episode. It was for the Browns annual golf outing, which a lot of players show up to. And we surprisingly, you know, it was pretty fun out there. What were your takeaways just in general from this event?
Yeah, at Westwood Country Club in Rocky River, it's been that's been the host of this charity event for about 5 or 6 years in a row now. What's interesting, Zach, is that the Browns did work today. They reported early in the morning as the new week, the final week, by the way, of OTAs, and did some walkthrough work, according to the coach, on the field, but mostly classroom stuff. And then they were out at the – they're still going on at Westwood – for their annual charity event to benefit the Cleveland Browns Foundation.
Yeah, no, definitely. And I know you guys talked to Joel Bitonio, who I think hasn't been at OTAs. So that was, I think, good for you guys to hear from him. What did Bitonio have to say? I know, you know, there's some retirement talk, all this kind of stuff. So what did he get into?
Yeah, you know, in Joel's exit interview in January, he was very down about the way his season ended. Not only the fact that he had to play through injuries, but he couldn't even practice. He didn't think his level of performance was up to his standard. And so, you know, he is, what, 32, going on 33. So he talked about today about how rejuvenated he feels. He's healthy. He's looking forward to this, you know, having a big comeback season. He thought last season was one of his worst seasons individually. But now I asked him the question of how long do you want to do this now? And he pointed out, you know, he's entering his 11th year. Injuries finally took the toll on Joel Thomas in his 11th year. So he feels any year from now on is a bonus, and he's just taking it 1 year at a time. He looks great. He feels great. It's all a matter of, you know, what kind of season his body has, really. And he feels better that it'll be more of a typical season for him than last year was.
Were you guys able to ask him any questions about the transition from Bill Callahan to Andy Dickerson? Did he have any thoughts on that?
Yeah, you know, they all respected Bill Callahan, but they don't want to slight their new coach, Andy Dickerson. He pointed out, again, Andy Dickerson actually worked out Bitonio when I think Andy was working for the Rams at the time. And Bitonio, of course, went to, what, Oregon State, I think, or Oregon. And Dickerson was sent to the Rams to work him out. So he has, a relationship that goes back that long with him. Mm-hmm. And he's pleased at what he sees. He's talked to different players who have played for Andy, like our center played for him in Seattle.
Yeah.
Posick played for him. Also, yep. Austin Corbett, a former member of the Browns, who played for the Rams, played for Dickerson. So he feels good about things. He also mentioned the assistant coach from Philadelphia, Roy Isfan, who's very well thought of. I asked him, you know, my concern was, and I wondered if he had the same concern, that the emphasis on more of a spread, shotgun spread offense, how would that affect the running game? And is he concerned at all that it would kind of decimate it from what we were used to seeing in the last 4 years? And he didn't think it would. He's confident that Andy Dickerson and Kevin Stefanski will continue to have, you know, the running game to be a vital part of the Browns offense. It remains to be seen. We haven't seen nearly the end product of what they're working towards, but he doesn't share my concern.
Okay. Well, it's good to always hear from Bitonio. Definitely, you know, one of those vets that always carries a lot of opinions. You guys also heard from Kevin Stefanski. What did Stefanski have to say?
Kevin didn't have any news nuggets per usual to drop on us. He does expect more veterans to be in attendance this week. This is really the last week of OTAs. Then they go into the mini camp the following week. It's the end of spring, really. He expects a couple more to show up. There were about over a dozen key veterans who were not present last week when the media were there. Media will be at OTAs on Wednesday for another session. So we'll see. He doesn't expect any change in the Deshaun Watson's, you know, alternate day throwing regimen right now. It's not his call. It's the medical people's call. And they haven't indicated any change in that. So we'll see out there Wednesday if there are any changes.
And then I know the big question whenever anybody brings up Stefanski or Andrew Berry right now, status of their contract extensions. Have you heard anything about that?
Yeah, as a matter of fact, Zach, I did. First of all, there's no setback. They're both going to get extensions. They're going to run parallel courses for how many years they determine. From what I understand, one of the men are done, whether it's Berry or Stefanski, I don't know. And the holdup with the other one is that the agent of that person has a lot of players around the league that he's doing new contracts for, and he just hasn't prioritized, his coach or GM client. So it's gonna happen. The Haslams have not changed their mind. The GM or coach hasn't changed their minds. It's gonna happen soon.
Well, that's good to know, and I think we'll, reassure a lot of Browns fans who are kind of been, waiting for that news to hit. Yeah.
Nothing there out of the ordinary. There's
nothing out of the ordinary. Tony, a good face to see out there today, Nick Chubb, because I think a lot of the times during OTAs, Chubb is working out inside, so we don't get to see him. It was good to see Nick Chubb walking around the Browns golf outing today.
Well, I heard he was there. I did not see him, so I'm glad that you were
I got able eyes to take on note him. Of him.
Yeah. Was he playing or just riding in the car?
No, not playing. So they had Tony, is they had a group of players playing, and then they had like a bigger group of players where they were bringing him around, introducing him to partners. So Deshaun, Nick Chubb, and Elijah Moore were all on a golf cart going around to meet people, talk to people. So that was that group. So Nick was with Deshaun.
Okay. Okay. Yeah. So then the question is, what's new with Chubb? Mm-hmm. And I think at the end of next week, after the minicamp, the last day of minicamp, we'll get an update on what they expect Chubb's timetable to be. When they expect him to even be cleared to practice or even do more visibly to the media in training camp. Again, I wouldn't raise anyone's expectations to think that Nick Chubb is going to be there from day one. It's just not going to happen. But we might have more clarity about when it will happen next week.
Hopefully. Definitely. And then another player who is coming back from injury that we hadn't seen a lot of that you made note of last week, Jack Conklin was there again today. Looking good. Obviously, he's coming back from ACL, MCL surgery, I think. So he was also in attendance, Tony, not playing golf.
In September.
So he was in attendance too. So definitely caught eyes of him at the outing as well.
Yeah, I doubt that we'll see Conklin at working out at mandatory minicamp. He, of course, will be there, but I don't expect to see him on the field until some point in training camp. Last week we noted that Jedrick Wills and DeJuan Jones were back. DeJuan Jones did a little bit more on the field, in fact, than Jedrick Wills did. So all three are off crutches and at different points of their recovery from their season-ending injuries.
Definitely. And then I want to kind of like wrap it on this, Tony. So you wrote last night on Land on Demand a pretty in-depth article about the new kicking rules coming to the NFL, how it's the hybrid XFL rule, all that. We've gone about that a lot and gone through it. It's a great article. Everybody should go read it because it clearly explains everything going on. But I don't think there's three people in Cleveland more excited about this than you, Bubba Ventrone, and Mike Vrabel. Those are the three most excited people about this in Cleveland. Yeah. So what's your vibe from Bubba on all of this?
Well, he's really excited. Every special teams coordinator sees this as an opportunity to get an edge on their counterparts, to come up with something creative. Because there are loads of creativity that can be used in this play. And Bubba's excited about it. In fact, he has told us he's going to be practicing kickoff coverage on Wednesday. So that's not It's not as exciting as the kickoff return phrase. Anyway, after we had met with Bubba last week at OTAs, the story came out that Andy Reid, the Kansas City coach, was going to use Justin Reid, a safety, as his kickoff specialist, because he wanted an extra player on defense. You know, we've talked about how this play could expose the kicker even more than ever as a potential tackler. And so now it turns out that Justin Reid has a little bit of experience. He kicked when Harrison Butker missed some time with a hamstring or whatever. Yeah. He wasn't great, but he's done it. And he's also a former soccer player. So I asked Bubba today, you know, to me, it makes a lot of sense. Is that such a difficult kick to kick the ball, you know, 50, 60 yards in the landing zone so that you can only use the professional kicker? And doesn't it make sense to have an extra defenseman on the field for this play? Yeah. And Bubba said, you know, first of all, these guys are professional kickers, and we require our kickers to place the ball in certain areas, not just in that 20-yard landing zone. He wants it close to the goal line, his kickoff. So that's close to a 65-yard kickoff, 65 yards in the air. They kick from the 35. And he said, that's not as easy as it sounds. And, in addition to that, he worries about a freak injury, because when you're kicking off, you know, you're using a different muscle than you would just running as a safety.
Yeah.
And he thinks right now there are more disadvantages than advantages to doing it, but he wouldn't close the door on perhaps checking into anyone who's has a history of kickoffs in high school or college, you know, and train them a little more on off the side. You're going to need a backup one anyway, right?
Yeah.
So he's open to it, but he's not enthused about it.
What, Tony? So this, I was reading your article, and I think I got it down, because it's a lot to take in, a lot to figure out. What happens if they kick it and it bounces and goes into the end zone? What happens then?
Okay, first of all, you have to recover it. It's a live ball.
Okay, so it's not just a touchback if that happens,
no,
right?
No, no. There's no fair catches and let the ball go. That's all out. So you have to recover it. If you recover it and down the ball, I think I wrote in there, it comes out to the 30-yard line, okay? If it goes, if it's a kick that goes out of the end zone and you're unable to recover it, it comes back to the 20-yard line. Okay, so it's a
10-yard difference there.
Yeah, if you kick it out of bounds or it hits before the landing zone, it comes all the way out to the 40-yard line. So that nobody wants that, right?
Yeah,
kicker will be benched for something like that. So, yeah, there are a lot of little nuances there that we'll all get accustomed to over time.
Yeah, because I'm trying to think, there's almost a strategy of, like you said, Tony, if you have, like it almost brings me back to, like, these coffin corner punts. Like, if you have a punter who can coffin corner punt and really pin down inside the 5-yard line, like, is there going to be opportunities for that now with the kicking game, you know?
Yeah, but you can't risk the ball going out of bounds, you know. In a punting game, it doesn't matter. You're not penalized for that.
Yeah.
But the whole rule format is geared to encourage returns, okay? Yeah. So you have to learn how to defend returns, because there's going to be – I can't imagine there'd be any touchbacks unless you do kick the ball out of the end zone. So I think it's going to be real interesting. I think it's going to make, you know, the preseason game something to watch, because it's really the first time we're going to be able to see it in action. Where special teams are not practiced full speed with contact at practice and training camp. Yeah. So I think it's going to be fun. I know Bubba is super excited about it, no doubt.
So then, Tony, like you said, mandatory minicamp next week, last week of OTAs this week. Anything you're looking for as we go into that?
I think it turns up a little bit of a notch at minicamp. There's a little more competitiveness that goes on. I'd like to see, since Winston will probably be throwing in the 7-on-7 and team drills, to see him winging it, you know, in a live setting, or as live as it can be in minicamp. I'll take a closer look at him behind center or out of the shotgun and see what he's got, what kind of game he's got left.
There's not, we're not expecting any surprise no-shows for minicamp, right?
Certainly no contractual issues or protests or things like that.
You don't, how do I want to say this? Because I don't want, because I do not know anything and I don't want to paint this in the wrong way, but there's been a lot of wide receiver deals recently. Justin Jefferson just got paid today. Amari Cooper is going into the last year of his deal. Do we know that that's like fine or just, you know, like they expect him to be there next week, everything's good?
To my knowledge, now he hasn't been prevalent in the voluntary sessions yet. We'll see, first of all, if he's there Wednesday. It was my understanding that the Browns wanted to talk about a short-term extension. Mm-hmm. And I would think that would benefit them and Cooper. So I don't have any information, you know, to contradict that. I'm not sure. Cooper's, you know, he's got the second highest salary cap figure on the team. So the Browns will like to reduce that with a new contract for sure. So it's something to watch, but I get the impression that that could be the next contract extension done.
Gotcha. Okay. It's just with all these wide receiver deals getting done, you never really know with that stuff. So, all right, Tony, fun day today. I know what's killing you to be around those tee boxes and not get to tee off. So
it was tough. Real tough.
You and Riz were both chomping at the bit to just get out there.
Yeah. And they had a beautiful day and good for them because it is a worthy cause.
For sure. 100% is. All right, Tony, we will talk to you tomorrow. And then as we get into OTAs and all that, rest of the week and then mandatory minicamp. You have a great day, Tony.
All right, you do the same.
All right. Thank you.